The ideas expressed in the following presentations are those of the speakers and do not necessarily reflect the views of ACI or its committees. ACI web sessions are recorded at ACI conventions or other concrete industry events and will be made available for viewing free of charge for 1 week. Thereafter, they will be archived on the ACI website or added to ACI's online CEU program, depending on their content. You can earn continuing education credits through ACI's online CEU program. Visit www.concrete.org to register. ACI conventions provide an opportunity for networking and for keeping up to date with the latest in concrete technology and practices.
At this time, then, it gives me great pleasure to introduce Gustavo Parra, who is my co-organizer for this session, and who really did the lion's share of work. Gustavo, welcome.
Thanks, Jack. Good afternoon, everyone. Again, my name is Gustavo Parra. I used to be at the University of Michigan. For those of you who don't know, I switched to the University of Wisconsin, Madison, about 3 months ago. And this presentation is together with my former PhD advisor and colleague at the University of Michigan, Professor James White. And what we decided to talk about was on a topic in which Mete Sozen has had a profound influence, directly and indirectly. Directly first as a pioneer in the identification of this particular topic, and later on through the work of his former students. So, the topic is designed for controlling shear strength decay in reinforced concrete members. And we're going to go from stirrups all the way to then fiber reinforcement. So just to give you a brief outline, I'll start talking first about the state of affairs at the time the PCA book came out in 1961. So I will talk about what is it that the PCA book had in or didn't have in this topic, and also the closest ACI code to the date, that was a 1963 ACI code. Then I will move on to the various research projects that were conducted that had some relation or complete relationship with the phenomenon of shear strength decay in reinforced concrete members. And when I said members, I will focus primarily on beams, even though a lot of work has been done on columns. I will mention some of that, but it will be primarily on beams. So I will start with a early research during the 60s and all the way probably until 1980, and that was the fundamental research when the phenomenon was identified, then the causes also identified, and methods to mitigate this problem were proposed. Then I will talk about the incorporation of the results from those research into the 1983 building code and how that has continued or is still in, used today. Then we'll talk about the 1990s, and then we'll go into another solution, which is this use of fibers in the 2000s. And I will finish with, oops, something happened there. So I will finish then with summary and recommendations. All right. So. What did the PCA book had with regard to shear strength degradation? Well, didn't have actually anything really on that because there was no research being done yet on the subject. However, it was where this capacity design for flexural members was introduced, where basically you had to calculate the shear force in the member for earthquake resistant design based on the capacity, flexural capacity of the member. So this was back in 1961 when that was first proposed, and it is still used today. Now, in terms of shear design, they had the typical contribution of the concrete and the steel. Now, one interesting thing is that even though there was no shear strength decay recognized, they did have a limit to 6 root of F prime C in terms of the maximum shear stress recommended in that book. Now, the V sub C term, they took it as the first term of the typical ACI code equation, so 1.9 root of F prime C, the ACI code, as we will see next, had a second term there. And then we have the contribution of the steel reinforcement. So this was pretty standard there. So the innovative aspect was probably the sixth root of a prime C limit. However, it also recognized the importance of the amount of transverse steel, and even more importantly, the need for confinement to keep the integrity of the concrete core. So they had a minimum requirement or recommendation for transverse steel to be applied over 4D from the member support, maximum spacing of D over 2, but within 2D, then you were required, or they recommended the use of hoops, closed stirrups with 135 degree hoops. So that was pretty innovative at the time, and the maximum spacing was not only D over 2, but there was a provision also for controlling or delaying buckling of longitudinal reinforcement. More relaxed than what we use now, but still there was that, the recognition of that problem there. Now, what do we have in the 1963 ACI code, which came out a couple of years after the book? Well, the shear stress limit was actually 10 root of FMC, so it was quite higher than the limit proposed in the PCA book. This is because there was no recognition of an earthquake problem there, so basically the same stress limit was applied in all cases. And again, this is the V sub C term. The first term is the one that the PCA book had, and then you had the influence of reinforcement ratio and A over D ratio, and it was limited to 3.5 root of A prime C. Now, in terms of spacing, they had the D over 2 for all shear stresses up to 6 root of A prime C, and you were required to take it down to D over 4 if you had larger shear stresses, so between 6 and 10. Minimum reinforcement was in a different format, but it led pretty much to comparable amounts of minimum shear reinforcement as in the PCA book. And but there was no modification, no requirement for confinement in this ACI code, so no modifications for earthquake-resistant design. Now, trying to find out what was probably the best, the first research on which reverse cyclic loading was applied. At least the one I could find was this work by McAllister, Sees, and Newmark at Illinois, published in 1954. Now, they evaluated the effect of one load reversal, so it was only one cycle. Professor Sozen told me that that was primarily because of they were looking into blast. They were not actually looking into earthquake behavior. But indeed, they did apply one reversal of the loading. And you can see, actually, this is the copy that you can find at the Illinois library. It seems to be actually Newmark's copy, still with some of his corrections there in terms of the initials going after the last names and things like that. Now, sufficient transverse reinforcement was provided to prevent shear failure. That might sound normal if you want to evaluate flexural behavior, but the way they did it, they were probably the first ones to identify the need for V sub C equals 0. And I took this statement from the report. The spacing was either 4 or 6 inches and was so that the stirrups would be capable of carrying all of the predicted maximum shear force at the unit stress not in excess of their yield point. That's basically what we do right now in earthquake-resistant design. That was probably the first time that was done, even though that was not, I mean, they knew that was the right thing to do if you really want to make sure you don't have a shear failure. Now, Professor Yirsa had this photo. He had a much better resolution, so I'm glad you got the opportunity to see it. The first probably comprehensive series of tests done on flexural members and the reverse cycle loading were done by Professor Ned Burns and Chet Sees at Illinois in the early 60s. Now, I'm putting two dates here that had to do typically with the report and with the major journal paper dates. They were likely, or in many cases, earlier papers, so this is not necessarily the fact when the research was conducted. But anyway, shear failures were again prevented in this test, and the shear stresses were kept relatively low, less than typically 3 root of FMC. Now, again, we can see Professor Burns here. I was expecting Professor Yeser to say who the other guy was because I don't know. But anyway, the key in terms of the behavior was likely, besides the detailing of the plastic hinge, this low shear stress. And basically, the issue of shear strength degradation didn't come out because of that. So it was meant to evaluate primarily flexural behavior under reverse cyclic loading. And they got three tests on the reverse cyclic loading. They did many more on the monotonic loading and compared actually their behavior of these specimens, again, under monotonic and reverse cyclic loading. And you can see a nice flexural dominated behavior, full loops, very large deformation capacity, and again, because part of it, the shear stresses were kept fairly low. Now then came Brown and Yirsa, Texas, but not University of Texas at all, since that was at Rice University. And that was probably the first time the shear strength decay phenomenon was explicitly recognized. And I'm showing a couple plots here. These are very large displacements, by the way, about 11% drift. But you look at one specimen on the left with low shear stress levels and shear reinforcement that provides a strength much larger than the demand. And then you have another one with a shorter aspect ratio and therefore higher shear stress levels and shear reinforcement such that it's pretty much to take apply shear. And what you can see actually in one, the low shear stresses, you can get several cycles with little degradation of strength. Now in the other one, you can see that as soon as you start repeating the cycles, there is quite a bit of degradation in strength. And they attributed this with this phrase. So shear was the major factor governing behavior. The apparent shear failure was produced by abrasion over a surface formed by a combination of diagonal tension cracks, a nearly vertical flexural tension cracks resulting from load reversals. Higher deflection limits reduce the number of cycles to failure. That might think obvious now. It wasn't obvious there. Reducing the stirrup spacing increased significantly the number of cycles to failure, and reduction of the shear span resulted in failure in fewer cycles. Then came Professor White and Professor Sozen. This was the first work of shear strength decay in reinforced concrete columns. So they had actually specimens with and without actual force, and they noticed that the decay in shear strength is less when you have actual force. Now, I should mention that the actual force that they were applying were healthy actual forces, always below the balance point. No, it doesn't mean that you can go crazy and go way above the balance point, because this is not going to hold true. Now, they also had this very interesting figure. I just added these marks in red to identify this thing a little bit better, but what they have in this plot is basically the vertical axis represents the applied shear, the horizontal axis represents ductility. And one line basically is the total applied shear versus ductility. The other one is a calculated based on measurements contribution of the transverse steel. And so the distance from the x-axis to the first line is the VS term. The distance between the two lines is the V sub C. Now, if you take the V sub C and information there and plot it versus ductility, this is what you get. So you get V sub C, which holds constant at low displacements, and then, in this case, was assumed to decay linearly all the way to zero in the end if you have very large deformations. So these sort of plots have become familiar or became familiar in the 90s, and now they are almost standard in many design procedures, but this was probably the first time this format was used. Now, more importantly, there was this very elegant definition of the shear strength decay problem. Now, this plot shows the applied shear force versus the strain in the one of the stirrups. And what you can see is that once you have diagonal cracking, the stirrup starts to work, and then, you know, you have a permanent strain in the stirrup as the load is removed. Now, when you reload again or reverse the loading, there is further yielding of the stirrup, and the increase in permanent strain continues. Well, that's what they assume, or they said leads to the shear strength decay, because he says that basically the concrete section which most ultimately provide the compressive thrust becomes distorted. As a result, shear strength decays. And I couldn't find any more elegant definition for the shear strength decay problem. Now, other conclusions, if reinforced concrete elements are designed to resist earthquake effects, basically the transfer reinforcement must be designed to take the entire shear. That is nothing else than the V sub C equals zero we have in the code. The use of closely spaced stirrups that are designed to carry all of the shear does not necessarily prevent shear failures. And this is a key conclusion. People think that you just provide V sub C equal, or you use V sub C equals zero, and whatever you get, that's enough. No. You have to maintain the integrity of the concrete core through confinement. That's the amount of steel by itself is not enough. Spacing of the stirrups should not exceed 1/4 of the effective depth. And there was one conclusion that actually I didn't put there, but had to do, and Professor Yisa mentioned it, with the effect of string hardening in the calculation of the expected moment capacity to then calculate the applied shear. Now, there was also some work by Popov, Bertero, and Krawinkler at Berkeley. They did three RC beam tests on the relatively large shear stresses, 6√8 C. And they also noticed degradation of shear resistance. They assigned part of it to a loss of bond between stirrups and the concrete, which they claim allowed the section to expand more than if you had a better bond. And as Professor Yusan and Brown had noticed earlier, aggregate interlocking loss due to abrasion of the crack surfaces. And they also suggested that you should probably use V sub C equals zero. Then Professor White at Michigan did additional work with Scrimer, and basically to look at the effect of shear stress level and the presence of intermediate longitudinal reinforcement on shear strength decay. So you can see two plots here, one without intermediate bars, the other one with intermediate bars. The one without intermediate bars actually studied the showing shear strength decay with cycling. The one with intermediate bars, even though it was subjected to a slightly higher shear stress, show a later decay in the shear strength. So it could take more cycles at a given displacement. In other cases, it meant that you could go farther before the shear strength degradation starts. And then the 1983 ACI code basically took a lot of these recommendations, especially from the work by White and Sozen. So the V sub C equals zero was introduced for the design of beams. Then V sub U calculated based on capacity design and using an expected flexural capacity, not a nominal one. And then the need for confinement in the plastic hinge. So over 2H, and they have some maximum spacing requirements. And also the fact that every other longitudinal bar has to be supported as four columns. And this has remained basically the same for almost 30 years. The provision for maximum spacing was modified in the last version of the ACI code, so it was made a little bit more stringent. Now, I should mention, though, that the provisions in the code are minimum requirements. So if you really want to stay out of trouble, you should keep your shear stresses low. That's what's going to give you a healthy design, of course, with confinement. But if you are designing for high shear stress levels, you may end up being in trouble. So if possible, keep shear stresses below 3√8 C. If you cannot do that, if you are between 3 and 6, then consider the use of intermediate bars, which was shown to be very effective for this shear stress range. And if you are required to design for higher than 6, I should advise you to just say no. Now then, in the 90s and early 2000s, a lot of the work actually was focused on defining a relationship between the V sub C and the deformation measurement, typically a measure of ductility. And there are different models that have been proposed at UC Berkeley by Professor Mete A collaborators at UC San Diego. And there was also, or there has also been work done on the estimation of drift capacity at shear failure, and more recently at collapse, and Purdue University, UC Berkeley, and in Japan also. So I just show a couple of the models. So there is no wide agreement into what sort of decay you have. That depends a lot on loading history and many other factors. But, you know, they all agree you do have this effect of shear strength decay once you go into inelastic displacement reversals. And I just want to finish just showing a few slides. It's related to some of my research on the use of fibers, but basically the idea is I've emphasized the need to keep the integrity of the concrete. One way that we do that traditionally is through confinement. Another way is through a combination of transverse reinforcement with a small reinforcement at the material level. So it actually keeps the concrete pieces tight better once cracking starts developing. So one of the things that will become obvious in terms of why this could be a good solution for delay shear strength decay is the comparison of cracking between a reinforced concrete member and some of the more advanced fiber concrete. You see a lot more cracks, a better distribution of deformations, and a much better integrity of the concrete under large deformations. To get this, though, you do need to have what we call a strength hardening behavior intention for the material. But the other advantage is that the material behaves as well-confined concrete before you look into the use of confinement steel. So just to show you a couple of specimens, same type of setup as the one that Professor Burns used with Professor Sis, RC member and fiber concrete element. The RC member designed for V sub C equals zero. At 4% drift, which is not trivial, you get quite a bit of damage. That's when failure really started here. You see actually very minor damage on the right, even though the right specimen had no stirrups. Of course, I'm not saying you should do that. What I'm saying is we did it as an extreme in an experiment, and it behaved fairly well. You can achieve larger deformations and under decent amounts or levels of shear stress and basically larger energy dissipation. And one way that we decided to look at the shear, not only for this sort of fiber concrete elements, but actually for reinforced concrete, you can actually look at the shear strain versus rotation ratio as we did here in the y-axis. And on the x-axis, you can take a measurement of the shear stress. And one interesting thing we saw was that typically specimens tended to show a constant ratio, which is expected, and then a drastic rather than a slow transition into the shear degradation, basically an increase in the shear strain with respect to the increases in rotation. And what we saw was for fiber concrete, that tend to happen above 0.3 root of a prime C. This is megapascal, so roughly 3.5 root of a prime C. It happens much earlier in reinforced concrete. So we recommended the use of 3.5 root of a prime C. So you can gain these if you use this sort of material, and therefore you could probably go into larger shear stress levels. So just to summarize, we've seen that the shear strength decay is primarily affected by displacement demand, shear stress level, and the presence of axial load, among others, but these are probably the main factors. And of course, the amount and the detailing of the transverse reinforcement, and the amount of spacing, and of course, how you distribute it within the section along the member length and within the cross section also. I want to emphasize this again, the use of closely spaced stirrups that are designed to carry all of the shear stress does not necessarily prevent shear failures. Confinement is the key thing. Best practice to stay out of trouble, keep shear stresses low, hopefully less than 3 root of a prime C if possible, with proper confinement of the concrete core. For moderate shear stress levels, consider the use of intermediate longitudinal bars. And maybe for high shear stress levels, this could be, if you cannot get away by increasing the section dimensions, then maybe looking into some of these alternatives like the use of fiber reinforcement. Now, I want to finalize by saying I consider myself probably a grandchildren of Professor Sozen, since I was one of his students. But I also have the privilege of being the father of his assistant grader for earthquake engineering homeworks. And this is actually Professor Sozen grading homeworks of his earthquake engineering class. So many of us have a grader. He does the grading himself with a little bit of help. Thank you, Mete, for all of your contributions, and thank you all for attending.
Thank you, Gustavo. We have time for some questions. Yes.
Gustavo, should we design columns assuming that V sub C is zero in that case also? You know, the ratcheting of strains in the stirrups that you showed there happens in columns too. One. Two, do columns reach higher drift ratios than beams under similar circumstances? And then if not, why do we make that, why do we penalize beams and not the columns?
I'm going to answer with words from Professor Sosa. In this handbook that was edited a few years ago by Bertero, he answers, I think, that question. Why do we differentiate between beams and columns? And one, of course, you could claim you could have a little bit of help from the actual force if you have a healthy actual force present. But I think what I remember he mentioned was that there is this belief implicitly that the column will not see the same sort of levels of deformation demand that the beam will see. I'm not saying that that's necessarily the case, but I think he said that there's this belief behind differentiating between columns and beams. So there's your answer. But I think, you know, if you do have a healthy level of actual force, definitely below the balance point, you get a little bit of help there. But you're right, and I remember your test where you had the same progression of inelastic deformations, and you're going to have the same phenomenon happening. The other thing, I think it's impossible, or it could be very difficult to have columns for V sub C equals zero. So there might have been some push from practice too.
Gustavo, I think we'll give you some more time at the beginning of the next session.
Yes.
So we'll let you go. Thank you.
Thank you.